sorry, in COP16. And to be honest, I'm not sure if we have made a lot of progress on the topic. Because as we are going to discuss today, this can mean different things for different people. It can be interpreted as an opportunity, as something we have to do in any case, or as a potential threat, and in some time, a new way of protectionism. And obviously, we have to make it work for everyone, because international trade is not something that countries can decide unilaterally. So the question is on what we are going to agree on. But also, I mean, the civil society have very, I would say, contrasted views on the topic, honestly. And that's what I call my presentation, International Trade and Environmental Sustainability, I love you, millionaire, the thème moi non plus in French, because sometimes you will see governments and even academics say there is no conflict. There are positive synergies. It's not even like there is an option to say, do we need more or less trade for climate adaptation and mitigation? The answer is yes. But if you go to the society, to the NGOs, the narrative is very different. Trade is often seen as a bad word, to say the least. And there's a good reason for that. It's not that if one side is right and the other is wrong. So the question is really at which condition we can make it work for the advanced economies, the middle-income economies, and the low-income economies, but also that every part of the society agree on that. Because if we don't find a consensus and compromise, we are going to see, you know, either unilateral policies or boycott by some organization, and in any case, that will limit what we have to do. So, now that you have my main story, and so I'm not sure in which direction. Was that perfect? So, the basic narrative is what? Is that on one hand, we have scarce resources on this planet, and we want to use them in an efficient way. And international trade is about that. You know? Now, there is some condition really if we want to deliver on that. Then also, if mitigation and if protecting both the climate and biodiversity is a need, climate change is happening. So we also need to think about adaptation. And international trade also contributes in adaptation, just because it's allowed to adapt to new climatic conditions, new comparative advantages, it helps to deal with shocks. But also, if we want to adapt at one point, we need to innovate. If we want to innovate, we need to invest. And the bigger the challenge, the bigger the investment, and so you need a bigger market to recover your investment. So some investment will never work in a small country, so you need a regional or global market to make it work. Now, international trade can contribute to mitigation effort, as you will, and as you know, actually all the countries are not efficient to produce even 1 liter of milk in the same way. So we would like to produce milk where there is a lower footprint in CO2. And finally, there is a lot of policies that are put in place, and governments are starting to spend a lot of money potentially in some of that, or have new regulation. Now the question is, are they going to help, or are they going actually to lead to more conflict? Okay. So just now that you have the upset, we have produced a large amount of food, you know, over the last 60 years. We have basically moved from more than about 4,000 calories in average per person. Of course, part of these calories go to feed cattle, so at the end we have less for human or for biofuel, to 6,500. So actually we produce much more, and the major problem we have on food insecurity today is about distributing this food and income inequalities. But producing food so far was not so difficult, mainly because Latin America in the last 30 years have filled the gap that traditional economy we are not able to do. And of course, for the next 30 years, Latin America is going to continue to play a role, but we also have to think about Africa, how Africa is going not only to produce food for itself, but for the world. And Now, at the same time, the trade of food has increased. We have moved from about less than or about 10% of the calories that were internationally traded 60 years ago to about 25, and the year-round already helped for that. We see in the 90s how the agricultural trade has increased. Also, China in the WTO and the demand from China has shifted markets, but global markets have operated. And on the right-hand side, you see a map that shows the ratio between your protein consumption and your imports. So if you are green, actually you have a negative ratio, meaning you have less surplus. And the bluer you are, the more a deficit. And we clearly see how basically the tropical region right now need to import food. When from Argentina to Canada, you have large food exporters. And it's also due to the fact that a lot of crops and a lot of technology that we have developed over the last century was really well adapted to climate north and south of the two tropics. And so we will have to think about investment in the region, in the middle. So at one point, I will not I still have only to figure it out. Maybe there's just some lag, so I should be more patient. And of course, so what we see on food reflects basically the fact that land is not distributed in the same way, water is not distributed in the same way. On this graph, on one axis, you have the rainfall per capita, and on the other, the land per capita. And so you can have Mongolia, a lot of land, and certainly a lot of extensive livestock activities, but not so much water. And at the opposite, you will have Guyana with a lot of water and not so much agricultural land if we keep some forest. And that's what also it means that if even every country can have agriculture, not every country can produce the same products. So trade is not about just moving calories, it's about food diversity, matching the natural resources that exist. In some places we can intensive agriculture to do vanilla, and in other places we still need a lot of land to do soybean. And so that means, you know, all these questions about local food system and self-sufficiency are major limits that are reality, okay? And also the world is more urbanized, and a city like Mumbai will never get all its food from a 200 kilometer radius. So that's this type of practicality that we have to keep in mind. On this one, just to say that something we have also looked at is when you factor climate change, the trade pattern over time is going to change. So we have to let it adjust. Here you see for some commodity the kind of market share in the baseline and what's happened when we factor in climate change. So for some commodities, the market share of Brazil will shrink. When for oil is going to increase. So it also means that, you know, what we have today is not what we have in 30 years, and we want rules of the trading system that will adjust to be changed. Because if we limit the change, and so to complex graph, but just to say that the purple bear is how much you lose if we block trade pattern due to climate change. The gray bar is for some country what you lose if you don't limit this trade pattern. So it's really that if you have policies that try to fight all the trade patterns we evolve, both in terms of do I import more or export more. So export restriction, import restriction. But also what type of commodity I want to do and from where I buy them, you are going to have conflict. So that's why, you know, for example, regional integration makes sense, but to some limit. If you are in Tanzania today, it will still make more sense to trade with India, that is not in Africa, than with Morocco. So regional integration has to be part of the story. But I mean, the world is not just about borders and institutions run by men. Geography matters. Now, the last 2 points I want to make is first, also the world has changed as things in the year-round in the 90s. Haven't changed since we were talking about COP. And here I show for 4 groups of economy, high income, upper middle income, and lower middle income, and low income, they're traded in share in dollars, in calories, and they're all agricultural emission. And what you are going to see here, that first, the role of advanced economy has shrunk over time, both in terms of share in trade, when in terms of emission they remain stable. Upper middle income countries have in particular grown not so much in value but in calories, so a lot of production of staple, soybean, corn, rice. And well, actually, the high income countries have tried to maintain some of this share in value. And then, among the most striking things here is what you see with the low income countries. The low income countries basically doesn't export food. They export a few cash crops, but so cocoa is food, of course, but not what we can think about major food security. They import, but they don't really export, even if we start to see some growth. But the most striking thing is their share in agricultural emissions have increased. And that's a kind of taboo topic, I think, that we are dealing with today. That 10 years ago, it was 16% of the agricultural and land use emissions coming from low-income countries. Today, that's 23%. This is going to increase when their share in GDP is less than 3%. Why? Because they have a very inefficient agricultural system. They lack investment. Basically, the amount of CO2 you need to produce 1 liter of milk in Ethiopia is 50 times higher than in Europe. Okay? Or than 12 times more than in Uruguay, for instance. So we need to tackle this because the demand is going to grow. The role in agricultural trade will also grow in some places. But without investment, we will not get there. And the question is how we can trigger the right type of investment. Because we cannot say just, we don't care. You know, 1 ton of CO2, the fact that it comes from Ethiopia, China, the US, or Switzerland, in 1 ton of CO2. And globally, we have to think, what is the higher rate of return when we invest to reduce this? And the low-income countries have a lot of opportunity for that. So to conclude now, I'm nearly done. I just have to be patient and push on. There are three main, I think, direction, and I'm really happy that with all the speakers we have, they will give their views on that. Because in many advanced economies, you see today the fact to say, oh, we have carbon markets, or we have new regulation, and that is putting a cost on more farmers. So we need to protect them. And you have this question about basically carbon tax adjustment at the border. That can be seen as a second best instrument, but for sure, if it is not done with science and in a transparent way, that's going to be a nightmare. That's going to lead to more disputes. So the question is how we can agree on that. But there is also, and you see this map that comes from the report that I'm using, in particular on this slide, from Joe Glover for the Food System Economic Commission, and Joe Glover is a resource at IFPRI, is if we just put a $50 per ton of CO2 today, because a lot of poor economies have a higher footprint by unit of production, it means a much higher tax. So what it means? That we want to tax more the low-income economies, or because politically the discussion will be, we cannot tax them, so we get it for free. But it means that we will not even have an incentive for them to improve. So how we have to be careful with this notion of carbon border tax. Then there's all the subsidies we are giving to farmers, or we are going to give to farmers, depending where you are. And here there's a lot of greenwashing, not in the general terms where people, you know, or corporation, use an environmental narrative and different method to compensate their carbon footprint, but from the WTO perspective, what we call the green box. Because in the WTO, you have the agreement on agriculture that gives a lot of flexibility for countries to give money to farmers if there is an environmental dimension. But very quickly, everything can become environmental. And here also we are going to see the unfairness that rich economy have much more money and can give a lot of money to their farmers when actually they may not need so much, or what they can do in terms of mitigation is still limited, when the poor economies will not have the fiscal space to do it, and we are back 30 years. And last but not least, there is a question of innovation. As I said, we need to innovate. Government can help for this. Private sector can do it, but private sector need also visibility. You don't do investment if you don't know what is the policy in 10 or 50 years. Just before coming here, I was with the people from the banking sector, and they were saying, if only we know that tomorrow there is a carbon tax applied everywhere, the problem will be solved for us. Now, we have no clue what the policy will be and how it will be different from country to country. And that's a major reason why we don't really take commitments, because these policy uncertainties can really impact our investment over 10 or 20 years. But at the same time, there is a question of intellectual property rights also that will come in the topic of agriculture. When you innovate, when you develop new seeds, and you need incentive and property rights to innovate, but could we say to a poor country, oh, we have a technology that exists, but we cannot give it to you to deal with this pest, to deal with this new disease, and so that will be an important issue with a trade dimension, because as we know, for example, for health and drugs, WTO had to come with an agreement on this in order to avoid too many conflicts. And yes, what we need to deal with the crisis is more unity and consistency than conflict. Thank you.
Thank you. We may have tentatively established connection with our virtual, at least one of our virtual participants. Ambassador Gloria Ebrahim Peralta. Ambassador Ebrahim, can you hear us?
For the next 10 minutes, I can make my can you hear me?
We can hear you, so if it's all right, I'd like to go ahead and ask you a question.
They are muted.
They're muted?
We can hear you.
I hear an echo.
for your patience. So I wanted to just ask you, you know, we've been talking about how high-income countries, middle-income countries, low-income countries come into the conversation. And I wanted to ask you your thoughts on how, you know, the global south, you know, can, you know, we have different opinions, we have different voices and perspectives. How do those come together to sort of talk together, to sort of talk in a, with a common voice?
Well, first of all, I want to describe this participation and thank the organizers for this side event. Particularly, it's big to invite me to share with you my reflections. I don't know if you have promised that I will get help with you. No? Today?
We can hear you. We have a little bit of feedback, but we're okay. Please continue.
Security is important not only the quality but also the quantity and the diversity. than that, because it's naturally some countries created directly between food security and self-production, that's something that we surely do not consider that. We do not see that link in the same way, but it's respectful. But it's very difficult to tackle those type of trade barriers and resources. The second thing that I'd like to remark is that due to different problems that we're facing in recent years, like the COVID pandemic and the disruption of global value chains and geopolitical tensions, we can see that now agricultural trade and its relation with food security and sustainability has regained a very important role in the international agenda and in also in the agenda of international organizations. And that's some sort of fresh new year in the air for us to regain the importance of the issue, of this topic, and try to move forward, because as most of the countries know, since the Euro round in 1995, the progress that we have made in order to liberalize trade is minimal, as I mentioned, only in Europe. Again, I'd like to remark the issue regarding the topic of the relation between trade and food security and also sustainability in two different notions. One is the concept of domestic support, and the other is the concept of non-tariff barriers that we are facing nowadays. Regarding domestic support, you know that, as I mentioned, year per year, particularly in developing countries, provide a lot of a huge amount of money to the producers, and according to the figures that I mentioned, more than 800 billion dollars per year. And I had the pleasure to read a couple of months ago a report done by IFRI and the World Bank Group that mentioned that those type of domestic support do not only disturb production but also trade, but also sustainability, because they encourage unsustainable food systems. And it's important, because we had raised that issue several opportunities but didn't have the capacity to moderate those figures. And it's impressive to see that how domestic support not only affect our production in the developing countries, but we don't have the elements and the capacity to compete with those types of support, but also affect global values like sustainability. As I mentioned, that report creates mentions a lot of interesting ideas, like the one of repurposing subsidies. I fully agree with you. Our concern is like that type of initiative do not derive in greenwashing. It's, you know that Annex 2 of the Agreement on Agricultural 1995 was created in a different context. We don't have much limits regarding how we guarantee that domestic support does not create distortions, particularly on environment. We have a couple of alternatives, but we must be sure that even though we fully agree on the importance of not of avoiding that domestic support boost a sustainable food system, it's important also to avoid that the countries try to greenwash what they are doing now and try to keep things, keep business as usual, just changing the name of the program. Other ideas, maybe more creative, is that you can use that amount of money in other countries that have more capabilities to provide answers to global needs. So to give you an example, countries like Argentina or many countries in the Americas, they lack investment, as you mentioned. And I'm pretty sure that if you invest that money in countries that have the capacities, but also the technology, the institutionality, the knowledge, and the human resources to provide the world what the world needs, that is sustainable food products, I'm pretty sure that we would be much closer to the answer that we're facing today than using that money in countries that do not have the capacity. You can put more money and more money, but you will not find the answer there. So that's an idea that equal and other that the space agreement is a very strong legal instrument to avoid atomic measures. I have the privilege to attend the SPS, WTO SPS committee for several years, and it really works. To be sure, it's, we're talking about rules, and at the end of the day, the collective monitoring process at the WTO is the element that we, as a support, that we do have in order to avoid red, obstacles, and satisfy red obstacles, but I'm pretty sure that we do have a good international regulation, even though it has more than 20 years. But nowadays we are facing some countries that they have the right to elaborate new regulations, because naturally, as you mentioned, there's a conflict between in society that some people do not see that trade is the answer to the challenges that we're facing, the sustainable challenges that we're facing today. And we all know that some countries are elaborating new regulations regarding sustainability. And what the only thing that we request is elaborate those regulations in a transparent manner, based on science, but always speaking with exporting countries. But what I mean is that if you find a response or an answer that is not applicable to exporting countries, we are enhancing the problem that we have, because they will not find the answer to that. And it's important to keep that idea in mind. We're always open to discuss that. And as you know, it's a top part of our bilateral agenda with any country, because I know that it's a legitimate concern and that countries have to provide answers to civil society and to guarantee that people do not only have access to safe and nutrition, but also sustainable food. I know that's right, but what we need is to guarantee that the regulations that are that have that objective do not create unnecessary hardship, because we will be affecting food security and countries will not have the capacity to give responses to civil society, to the consumers. Just to conclude, I would like to say that one of the issues that we hear at this COP is normally we need to transform the system and we need investment, and for investment in money. And when you have the chance to see the amount of money that several countries provide to their producers to subsidize the production, you see that money is there. It's just a matter of priority. So I fully believe that money is there, it's just a matter of priority, and to give the money to those countries and those people that have the possibility, the capability, and the experience to provide global solutions to global concerns. Thank you very much.
If you can hear me, I can start and talk because we have a delay between us, and we lost the opportunity to share some reflections. Okay, well, let me start works of reflecting in the same workspace on these three issues that are interrelated. The recent events have shown us that food security, environmental security, and trade are three big issues and should play a determining role in the post-COVID economic recovery and have been impacted in turn by the war in Ukraine. Before answering your question about the actions of the South, the Global South, make two brief remarks. One, about the environmental sustainability at the WTO, because it's important to be clear that the sustainable development is enshrined in the WTO's funding agreement, and since the organization's of course in 1995, environmental issues have become increasingly prominent. Groups of WTO members ensured in December 2021, the last December, ministerial statements which outlined signatory plans of actions respectively on plastic pollution, trade and environmental enmity, and fossil fuel subsidies reform. And I think it's important to have highlighted that they are
sorry for the people online, but it's the first day. I think we already got something very important, is that actually the WTO work and some of the mechanism and the SPS committee can deliver. So sometimes people can be a bit gloomy and say nothing has happened, nothing worked. But we have some mechanism that can work. So how we can build on that is going to be very important. But the question about having countries that really want to play the game and to be transparent, at the end, it's a political decision. You know? So let's hope that with COP event, people can align, but beyond words, you know, they share a common vision, and after they give mandate to different organizations to deliver on it. But if we don't have a strong political will, unfortunately, we are going to be locked in this situation. Because as I've said, we have a number of problems on which we can find technological solutions, other cell solution instead of solution. But as that being said, where are your priorities? What do you really want to do? And do you really want to find a global solution or just to, unfortunately, as we said, to win the next election? And at one point, that's a big trade-off that we have to deal with. So we want to reconcile these two aspects. But that I think that's, yes, I think removing the policy uncertainties that many players face, investors, bankers, farmers, it's a major issue. And to some extent, we have not made so much progress on that, on this question about, oh, we want to make a food system more sustainable. So what are the policies we need? And we are going to keep them transparent for 20 years in order for people to act. So that's what I would say my priority. You know, is we are in a world where there's so many uncertainties today about prices, about inflation, about climate. The fact that we add this layer of policy uncertainties is an issue. And after, I think, yes, investment and technical solutions will come sometimes from the public sectors, and that's also where, you know, the CGI has a role to play. Because the other point that I've been very clear is that some countries already have human capital, researchers, farmers, that can adopt new technology very fast. You just need to unlock this potential, and a lot of answers will come from the private sector if you solve some issue and you address the finance aspect. But then you have other countries today that actually need a lot of direct support in terms of extension services, in terms of innovation for their particular, you know, product of interest. The private sector is not going to unlock millions of investment in yams or in millet tomorrow. So that's where, you know, the public sector has its role to play. And in other part, yes, the private sector. So that by, you know, two things. On one hand, the policy uncertainty, and on the other hand, thinking that different countries are in different situations, and we need to make sure that we provide the right condition and means for the different countries. And some can deliver tomorrow, other will make 10 or 15 years to catch up and deliver, but we are on the long run game here, so that's important.
Again, not an easy question, but I'm going to emphasize two concepts. One is that the Uruguay round was concluded, informally concluded, between two countries, the European Union and the United States. That scenario is not applicable now. We cannot wrap up an agreement without several countries. And we have not only more countries involved, but major countries that are very much involved, and they have professionals, very, very capable professionals, are very much involved and compromised with these conversations. The other issue is that, I think this is very much complex than the one that we had at the last round. IPR, as you mentioned, something very, very interesting. If we are always talking about innovation, but there's nonsense if you have the innovation that is not, agricultural producers do not have access to them, particularly in developing countries. So that's something that can enlarge the gap between what people who have money, people who that do not have money. But at the end of the day, it all depends on the political commitment and political willingness. Now that the Doha Round was launched a couple of weeks ago after the terrorist attack at the World Trade Center. And the global community wanted to send a signal to the world that we are united and we want to work together and that we believe in multilateralism, and that's the solution. Hopefully we will not have to face another situation like that to bring solutions, but I think that there are no individual solutions for this kind of problems. Argentina has been a very committed country in multilateral conversations, we're talking about negotiations, cooperation, but you see here a lot of commitment, but again, at the end of the day, we're talking about money, and money is obviously money for funding the transformation of the food system do not have to come only from public budgets. I fully believe that private sector has a lot of things to do in there, but it's a matter of priorities and commitment and political rights.
Thanks to you both.